A while ago, I was in the library, and I chanced to see a new book on the shelf by Woody Allen. Well, it wasn't new, it was new to me, and I haven't given Woody much thought in years, so I decided to read it. It was disappointing. The stories reminded me of ones I'd read before, years ago, so it was like being served cold leftovers. Woody had a real penchant for using big words, and there was very little punch or verve in the work. I don't think they'd have been published if they hadn't been written by a famous person. I was back in the library looking for a movie when I came upon one written and directed by Woody Allen. And I hadn't seen a Woody Allen movie in years, and I enjoyed the early comedies, so I thought maybe I'd give this one a chance. The name of the movie was Blue Jasmine. Rolling Stone, the magazine, in a cover blurb, said it was not to be missed. On the back, it was a New York Times critic's pick. I read the back copy. It was described as poignant, romantic, and mesmerizing, which is quite a triple play. Anytime I succeed at even one of them, I consider the day a triumph. It was also referred to as Woody's latest masterpiece, and that's quite the claim, since it means that just about everything Woody touches is a masterpiece, and this is the most recent in a long line. That convinced me, and I checked it out, of the library. Then I checked it out at home, on the TV screen. As with his book, I was disappointed. It might have been poignant, it wasn't romantic, just the opposite, I thought, and it never made it close to mesmerizing. One out of three isn't bad if you're a batter in baseball. I'm not saying that Woody has to be funny in order to be good, but I got to know him as a comedian, and in this movie there are no laughs whatsoever, or none that I recall. So maybe it's me who comes up short to Woody's more serious, Bergman-like stuff, his deep investigation into the dark channels of human nature, his latest masterpiece. Overall, because the main story concerns the mental breakdown of the central character, convincingly played by Cate Blanchett, the experience of the movie is quite depressing, which again is not to say that a depressing movie can't be good, but you would not want to have a pajama party and show this movie. There were things to like. It was 98 minutes long. Woody still loves jazz, although the use of music is very heavy-handed. Blue Moon. I get it, Woody. I don't know why he would make a movie like this, about people overwhelmed by distinctly first-world problems. It's definitely located in the shallow end of the pool. Maybe it's because things that were funny when he was young, things like sex and insecurity and sex and neurosis, are no longer so amusing to him in old age. The actors in the movie all seem credible to me. The plot contains some whopping improbabilities and crater-like holes that I was unable to accept, the way you can't swallow a donut whole, or not without significant difficulty. The movie didn't even feel original to me. I kept feeling that I was watching an offbeat remake of A Streetcar Named Desire. The similarities are way too obvious to ignore. Also, I found it impossible to root for anybody in the movie. In the old Woody films, Woody the Nebbish was always there, the consummate anti-hero who somehow bum stumbles his way to glory in the fine tradition of all the great silent comics. In this story, there's nobody. They're all venal or vile. Alec Baldwin plays a capitalistic villain, oozing smarm and insincerity. Louis C.K. plays a sex-hungry, soulless, predatory creep. The two unrelated sisters do have something in common. They both want what they want so much, the one material comfort, the other romantic love, that they are clueless idiots when it comes to making practical decisions. Having gone nowhere, except perhaps around in circles, the movie ends as it began, with the protagonist in the middle of a breakdown, a neurotic episode, talking to herself, and when a woman gets up from a park bench to avoid having to listen to her, I was with her. I wanted to go too. Fortunately, that was the end of the show, the part I liked best.